So the work that I've been doing is really focused on what I think are the two most profound selective forces that have acted on animals in evolutionary time, and those are light and sex. And light is reflected in the fact that I work in my laboratory on the way eyes grow and develop. But a second line of work has been in how reproductive behavior actually influences the brain. What happens when an animal engages in reproduction, and how does that influence the brain? Can it? And what we've been using as a model system for looking at this is an animal in which we can reproduce the whole natural situation of the animal's natural life. Now, this is important because so much about reproduction depends upon context. So in birds, there need to be nesting materials in the right amount of space, and in humans, we know it's complicated. In animals, it's no reason why it shouldn't be any different. So I chose a model system in which I could find a way to make the whole social system in the laboratory and watch what happens. What happens is, in this species, that there are two kinds of males, territorial or dominant males, who guard a small piece of real estate that contains food, and they are really interested in using that resource to solicit females. An old story in many species, but certainly in this one important because he has this resource and he can attract females to it. In Africa, where I did the field work, it was clear that there were only about 10 to 15% of the males who had these territories. So all the rest of the males had to figure out how to get food. So let me tell you first about the other males and then about the way the females system works. So the other males basically pretend they're females. So they actually mimic perfectly female behavior. They let themselves be solicited by these dominant territorial males. They let themselves be led back into the territory. They eat vigorously and to satiation while the male idly stands by. And then when the time comes to enter the spawning grotto and do the deed, in fact, they say, whoops, got other plans, and zip out of there. The male, sort of horribly deceived, chases them away, goes back, and tries again. If he does actually find a female in this species, which is one of the many cichlid fish from the central African lakes, and these are animals that are in their own right evolutionarily very interesting because they have had an explosive speciation over a very short time. He goes and finds a female. Let's say she's interested in spawning. She can choose from amongst the males who are arrayed above this food supply, choose one and eat, and then go into his spawning grotto to spawn with him. And this animal then spawns in the following way. The female is a mouth brooder. She actually lays her eggs, picks them up in her mouth immediately, and he has to then deceive her by showing her certain spots on his anal fin that look like eggs. He puts his sperm on top of that, and she then picks up the sperm that's actually above these egg spots on his anal fin and fertilizes the eggs there in her mouth. So basically, this complicated behavior, which involves deception on the part of the male of the female, takes a lot of time. While he's busy doing this down in his grotto, all the other males are in his territory eating like mad. Females, anybody who can get at it, this free food supply is there. So he has to keep her interested and keep the other animals out of his territory. So he's a very busy guy, zipping in and out, keeping her motivated, keeping the whole scene operating. And of course, as in most species, this version of the male is extremely bright, brightly colored. So they're the ones who are most susceptible to predators. And periodically, a predator will pick off one of these males. And then you notice that the non-dominant males can suddenly turn on their colors and rise to the occasion and take over the territory, or even insinuate themselves in amongst the territorial males and actually carve out a little territory for themselves. And conversely, there can be a big wind that blows the food supply into a heap. Many males lose their territories. And when they do, they turn back into the non-territorial, very colorless, drab, female-looking males and have to return to finding their way into dominant territorial males' territories to actually eat. So we became interested, and this is a code for we're wondering what happens to their brains when this happens. And lo and behold, discovered that when these animals become dominant, cells in their brain actually grow, parts of the brain get larger, produce more stuff, and the stuff is important for reproduction itself. And there are several kinds of changes that occur. So the changes include growing larger gonads, that's pretty obvious, growing more sperm, but also physically getting bigger really rapidly. If you gain a territory, you actually grow rapidly. If you lose, you shrink. You actually lose physical size. So there are these dramatic changes that are mediated by the brain that are simply driven by the behavior itself. There are no outside influences. So your social situation influences everything about your brain and your brain structures. The cells that get large may interconnect differently, produce different kinds of outputs. So there is a fundamental rewiring and re-engineering of the brain structures responsible for this kind of behavior. So the deep question is, how do you transduce social information into cellular and molecular physiological changes? How can you recognize social opportunity and have that become a signal inside your body that does so many different things? In retrospect, it's not surprising, of course, because this is an important feature. As I said, sex is what it's all about, and so there's no reason why we shouldn't have been able to imagine that this was going to be a major feature of how the brain works. But finding it, and finding it in this exquisite detail, has been pretty extraordinary. Now, in the part of this that's just come out recently is that these males not only are attending to the females and to non-dominant males, but they have a very elaborate social structure themselves. So the dominant male in a particular area, for example, can do basically whatever he wants. The next in order of dominance will actually watch that dominant male and only perform sort of aggressive acts when that male is not attending or is in a grotto with a female or is in some way out of view. Those who are still lower ranking watch both of those animals, so they are attending to everybody who's higher in the rank above them. And now we are pretty sure that each of those graded states of sort of behavior map onto subtle gradations in the physiology of the brain as well. So they may be calibrating these structures to match the social situation in a really elaborately beautiful way that makes sense in evolutionary terms, but I think is unexpected. And part of what's fun about doing this kind of science is that you can go from watching what an animal does to understanding something about the machinery that arises as a consequence of this kind of activity.